right, welcome back to Worst Season House. Michael Russo, Anthony LaPanta, coming to you from Split Rocks up here in Wyoming, from the Aquarius Home Services studio on location up here. Anthony, I was rattled when you walked in at 6:55. A 5-minute advance of you showing up is, like, to me, feels like an hour and a half, 2 hours.
I knew the Feller's Ranch guys were here tonight, and there was no chance I was going to be late when we were going to be talking about steaks.
No, no doubt about it. We're going to have the Feller's Ranch guys come up later in the show. We also, if you are lucky enough to come on out, or smart enough to come on out, we have a raffle at the end. We're going to do three raffles after the show is over for a $100 gift card to Feller's Ranch, a $50 gift card to Feller's Ranch, and a set of Wagyu steaks that you'll get to grill up and enjoy. And then everybody here gets Wagyu beef sticks from Feller's Ranch as well. So really excited about that. Anthony, let's see where to start. I ran into Lou Nanny yesterday.
Nice.
Guess where I run into him at the car dealership. I'm walking by and I hear that unmistakable Michael. And I look down and he's got somebody putting on his vanity license plates on his car. Like, I won't say what it is, because then everybody, when they, if Lou Nanny now drives by you, you are going to know it's Lou Nanny. Let's put it that way.
So you say what the license plate is.
I probably shouldn't, because I was originally going to take.
Do you really think if somebody saw him drive by, they'd wonder if it was him?
But now if you, like, plug it into something, you might find his address, all that. It's probably better not to give out his license plate. I think you can do that, right? I'm not a cop,
but
I run into him, and then I wound up going back to his house, which is like a museum of Lou Nanny collectibles his entire life.
What were you doing at a car dealership?
I had to get a service, and I had door dinks that I needed to get fixed. So that's why I was there. So, it kept on saying service, 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 and finally I'm just like, all right, I better take it in. It's telling me something. So
good thinking.
That's why I was there. So then I went back and hung out on his incredible balcony, incredible, like, back patio there, and smoked a cigar. It was a great day. It turned out to be an awesome day. I had nothing to do, and there you go.
Perfect. Sometimes it just works out. We talked about the story last summer. I just landed at his cabin and wound up drinking wine and eating great food for 4 or 5 hours, and probably could have stayed there all night if we didn't have to get back to grill some steaks.
That was the other thing that made me very nervous. That's when I let myself go. He basically had me. He had me on the phone with a mortgage guy, a realtor. So a cabin has suddenly popped up on Balsam Lake.
And you are a cabin guy.
And yeah, and I'm not kidding you, where he had me this close to buying it, like, on the spot. Like, I was honestly getting the shakes. He was, like, telling me how stupid it would be if I let it go. I can't wait a week. I got to get it now. He had me on the phone with people. I was, like, sweating profusely. Yeah.
You understand how cabins work, right?
Yeah, I know. There's bugs and stuff, right?
Well, there are bugs. But you have to go there.
Yeah, that's true.
To make it worthwhile.
Yeah.
You've spent about four days at home in Minnesota this summer.
That is true. What would I do if I, like, actually saw, like, a mouse or a snake?
Sell it.
Yeah, 100%. No doubt about it.
You might have to figure out how to run a lawnmower, which that would be a disaster.
No, I would hire out. Definitely hire out. It comes with a pontoon, too. Do you have to get, like, a driver's license to ride a pontoon?
Well, no, but you have to have a boat license.
Okay. Who's going to teach me how to do that?
I would actually pay money to watch it.
I can't even imagine how hard it would be to, like, park a pontoon.
Well, it's not hard, but I would pay money to watch you do it.
Yeah. All right. By the way, we got to get your raffle ticket, sir. Before we do the raffle, remind you got to come on up. All right, Anthony. Nothing's happened with the Wild this week. So you look like you've been, like, living on the golf course. Like,
I played the last 2 days.
Like, two? Yeah. Well, seems like three weeks.
No, I just had this series off. Previous weekend I might have played two, but I played the last 2 days. Had a good match today, beat up on Ariana a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Bad match yesterday, lost a skins game.
Do you wear, like, a hat, some sunscreen?
Yeah.
Sunscreen?
Sunscreen. I didn't have a hat on today.
I don't think you wear sunscreen. I think you should, though. I'm just looking out for you.
I listen to Margo.
Yeah.
It's, I have it on. But we had two great days to play. They're absolutely perfect. So, yeah, I've played some golf. I get the game back in shape.
Yeah, exactly. What do you want to talk about with the Wild?
I don't know. Nothing.
Yeah, I know.
Well, you keep bringing up Patrick Laine.
Yeah.
You still think this is a possibility?
Yeah, I think that the Wild are interested. I just don't know how, again, they could get it done. Like, unless you're trading, obviously it would have to be Goudreau on the deal, but it would have to be also like a, like, they'd have to figure out a way to get rid of a Marcus Johansson somehow, you know, because I don't see where they take Gustafsson. Right there in the middle. Like Gustafsson, but if they have Merzlikins, how's that going to happen? But I do think, and I will say, I've sort of changed my tune on this whole thing just because of his incredible social media the last week. One, he looks in fabulous shape. He looks in great spirits. And he and his fiance.
They can make almost anybody look like they're working out hard on those social media things.
Well, almost everybody.
They'll always make it. They're not going to show you the clip of him gasping for breath sitting on the side. They're going to show the one where he's, you know, squatting what looks like a ton of weight. And, I mean, I've seen some of the same things. I have the same concerns I've had all along with him. I mean, number one, I think the dollar figure is, it's just higher than I would be interested in taking on, and that's assuming that Columbus eats half of it. And I'd steer clear, but you never know. There's probably some upside there.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, I just get the impression from talking to a lot of people around the league that Billy's pretty motivated to try to figure out a way to get this done. And usually when he's motivated to do something, he figures out a way to do it. So, but again, the math is the math. If they didn't sign Trennan, it'd probably be done today. But the math is the math. And right now, they just don't have the cap space. Question.
So on Monday,
you didn't even wait. You heard Laine and you just like, come up here.
Yeah, I have no interest in Laine. But my question is, so on Monday, St. Louis RFA'd two Edmonton Oilers players.
Mm-hmm.
And then on Tuesday, your employer podcast discussed that. And one of the things they brought up is, why don't you RFA tender goalies? And so they brought up specifically Jesper Wallstedt, that they would tender him next year as an offer sheet if you were another team, because then you don't have to waste the draft pick and you accelerate the goaltender development process. And they talked about two other ones, Devin Levi, and I forget who the other one was.
Mm-hmm.
Your thoughts on potentially Wallstedt getting a RFA tendered offer?
Well, I mean, yeah, he technically could. It would be a risk. They would have a lot more cap space to get it done next year. So I would think the Wild would have the ability to match anything unless somebody's going to do something completely stupid. Now, St. Louis today, you know, I was talking to somebody, you know, in the league that I didn't hear it on Elliot's podcast, but I was talking to somebody in the league that said, and this was actually somebody that works in the NHL, that said they heard on Elliott's podcast that Edmonton's offer to Broberg was 1.8 and St. Louis signed him to a $4.8 million a year offer sheet. So basically gave him a $3 million raise on what he was even asking for in Edmonton. So yeah, if somebody does something ridiculous, you could do it. But to me, like if somebody offered like Wallstedt a $4 or $5 million offer sheet and the Wild were convinced that he still is the future number one of this team and that number eventually won't be completely out of whack, they're going to have the cap space to match it. If not, they're going to get a bunch of picks for it. So, you know, I think it's way too premature to worry about that right now.
I did think it was an interesting move by St. Louis.
Yeah.
And I haven't studied their cap situation closely enough, but clearly they had some cash left over and probably missed on some targets during free agency and thought, let's take a shot on these guys. Edmonton's pretty tight to the cap.
Yeah,
they didn't do it just to try to screw Edmonton.
No, but it is a bold move, and it does screw Edmonton in a lot of ways, obviously, because, one, the compensation that they would have to give up to this is really not something that's going to be a game changer for Edmonton. So if they lose them and don't match, you're just getting a second and a third-round pick, which obviously is not, you know, huge. You'd probably be able to get more in a trade for each of those players. You know, Stan Bowman has always been a huge rival of Doug Armstrong. You know, it's been talked about all over Twitter, and normally I roll my eyes at Twitter, but this is, I think, something that's valid, is Doug Armstrong and Kenny Holland are buddies. I mean, big-time friends, and nobody in the league, as respected as Kenny Holland is, thinks that he was treated fairly this year by Daryl Cates and the ownership leadership group in Edmonton that you can, you know, get basically, it was long known during the playoffs that this was, that he was leaving no matter what happened, if they won a cup or didn't win the cup. So he wasn't exactly treated, you know, I think in the eyes of a lot of people inside hockey, very fairly. And I think this was a way of Doug Armstrong screwing in the shiv, so to speak. Question.
Yeah, so a couple days ago, Nino Niederreiter partook in the...
I'm going to see him in a couple days.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
In that Switzerland tournament or whatever, the game on the mountain high yeah. up, you know, highest point, accessible point yep. in Europe. And thinking about that and putting aside logistics, because it would be impossible to think about, can you name some places where you would really want to see a game be played, whether it be an NHL game or anything of that nature, anywhere in the world?
I don't know. Lake Minnetonka would be kind of cool. you know, I mean, where do they? Where was it up in Alberta? Where they? I mean, it's supposed to be Alaska, where they filmed Mystery Alaska. I mean, those type of games. Like, I think a lake is something that the league would love to figure out. I mean, they had one at Tahoe, but it obviously was on the shore. I think the league would love to figure out a way to do something like that, something really special. But the pictures of what they did, I can't wait to talk to Nino about it. I'm going to Prague on Friday for the NHL Media Tour Europe. And I'll actually read you the list of players that I'm getting. It's just a sensational list of players. But Nino's the one. It's funny because it's like Pasternak and Aho and Nylander and all these like great, great players. But Nino is the one name on the list. I'm like, I can't wait to sit down with him.
Would it have to be a realistic place like that? Yeah. It could actually happen, because otherwise I'd pick Lake Como. But I don't see that freezing anytime soon. So
no, I mean, the point of it is anything. Like it could be on top of a mountain. It could be in the ocean. It could be wherever you want. You know, like yeah. what's a picturesque place, dreamy place?
Well, Lake Como is one of the coolest spots that I've ever stood in my life. And on the corner in Bellagio there, we did have an unbelievable picnic up in the Alps,
yeah.
right across from the Jungfrau Yoke, I think it was called. It yeah. was the highest point there. And we were on the other side, like, sitting there having a picnic. That wouldn't be bad either. It wasn't very level, so one team would have a significant height advantage with the playing. It wouldn't be playing with the wind. It would be playing with, like, the 45-degree slope. But
I would want the press. If we did it on Como, I would want the press box to be that that mansion that's in the show Succession. It's actually been on a lot of different types of shows. I think it's basically something that's rented out for movies and TV shows. But you know the one I'm talking about in Succession, where Roman and his dad meet with the guy that's going to buy the, you know, his company, and it's right. Oh, we took the boat right by that house. I remember seeing it, and it was before that scene was even in Succession. So we might actually be doing Como
it's
next
possible.
Summer. So maybe we can make this work. Because I think we're going to Milan on that trip too. So it'd be kind of cool because I'm covering the 2026 Olympics. That's a great question. I don't know. If we were doing it somewhere in North America, I would want it to be on like a pristine lake, I think. Yeah. So,
the second question I had was actually kind of hinting towards that. You guys just finished up a trip to Portugal. Any hints or clues where you're going next year?
We have a list of things where we'd start in like Lugano and go down to Como and then into like Monaco, Nice, Cannes. That's one. The other is Spain.
The other was Spain to go to Barcelona, yep. Madrid, maybe Valencia included in there. Those are kind of the two we discussed the most, but long way to go before we figure that out. The Portugal trip was terrific. It was, to me, it was the destination about which I knew the least heading in and learned a lot about it. The food and wine was outstanding. The wine exceeded by a wide margin whatever I knew about Portuguese wine. But I thought it was terrific. The Porto I loved. Lisbon wasn't my favorite city we visited. Just kind of felt like a big city. But Porto was really cool.
Yeah. By the way, again, if you ask a question, you can go and grab a T-shirt, a Talk North T-shirt. Question.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, good. Speaking to that microphone.
Yeah, he moved it. I suppose I better.
Huh? Yeah.
So I have a kind of like a comment, and then I have a question. The whole Liney thing, I'm really kind of shocked because he really doesn't seem like a
Bill Guerin type player.
Kind of player.
Yeah, especially after the summer of identity.
Yeah.
But maybe they fear they could maybe kill two birds with one stone. They got the identity guy in Trenineth, and they get the scorer on Laine. I mean, I think there was a lot of thought inside the front office that they do have to figure out a way to score more goals. Obviously, Bill Guerin genuinely believes that there's going to be internal improvement from a lot of guys that didn't score a lot this year. You know, Spurgeon's back.
Right.
Obviously, Hartman, you know, he scored 21 goals, but they expect more from him. Johansson, Foligno's healthy.
Right.
So they're hoping that, but I think that they like to take a lot of pressure off Boldy and Kaprizov.
Well, and I think it really comes down to that he's looking at an opportunity where he might be able to buy really low on an asset. I don't think he'd have interest in, like 2 years ago, I don't think he's knocking on the door to get Patrick Laine. But right now, there's a perception around the league that maybe he could be had for a lot less than what he otherwise would cost. Because I don't think normally, at any time a guy has bounced around like he has and bounced around because he didn't fit where he was, that's a red flag for me, and I think it would normally be for Billy. But right now, and before they're going to do this, they're going to make sure they know what they're getting in the guys as a guy.
Right.
I just think right now they might be looking at this as here's a chance to grab a guy who was a pick in the top two in the draft and maybe get him at a bargain basement price. It's worth a shot and just see what happens.
Yeah.
Right.
The one thing, you know, and also to Anthony's point on just how he's still not sold, the one thing, you know, to the one person that asked about Wahlstedt and offer sheets and things like that, I mean, this is stuff the Wild are going to have to think about and, you know, to get yourself locked into, even if you can get him at half price, that's still 4.35 for this year and next year.
Right.
And that really takes a team that's already has tight cap space next year because of the Faber contract and they want to extend out Kaprizov. They don't have a ton of cap space next summer, and so now you're locking yourself 4.3 and you're not giving yourself insurance policies if somebody comes in and says, you know what, you know, we've had no goalies for, you know, a decade here. Here's a guy that we can go get.
Right.
You know, now you see, I told you not to worry about it. Now you freaking put it in my head. Didn't even occur to me. This is why I don't listen to the Athletic Hockey Show. No, I'm just kidding. So, freaking Lazarus and Granger. There's no doubt it was Granger that was saying that because he's our goalie whisperer. And Granger took that spot. See, I was supposed to fill in on that and I couldn't. And Granger took that spot. And now he's just created this mess. All right. What was the question?
The question was, we're trying to figure out which games to go to, figure out our tickets for that.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think the Utah team's going to do?
They're going to be better than they were last year.
And they were tough for the Wild last year.
Yeah, I think they'll be one of the more improved teams in the league. I still don't think they're one of the top four in the Central Division, but are you talking about home games or road games?
Home.
Oh, home. Then I'd pick somebody other than Utah.
Okay.
Actually, those games are usually wild, though.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if you want to see a fun game,
right?
You know,
right.
Yeah, because they can't defend, so they usually.
I think they're going to be much better.
I think they will be, but typically they haven't been able to.
Yeah,
although some of the games have been low scoring, they haven't been for lack of chances.
Right. Yep.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Question, and then we're going to invite up Don from Feller's Ranch.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Two part. Which European is going to make the biggest impact on the Minnesota Wild roster? And then which European is going to make the biggest impact on the Iowa Wild roster?
Well, I mean, I would go with Kirill Kaprizov, unless you're discounting him.
Well, I'm thinking new blood.
New blood?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I'm hoping Ogren's going to be, I hope that he's... I mean, that's the one. I mean, you know, if you're discounting the Brodeans and players
Eric
like that.
And they, I mean, they've got a pretty good European feel on the roster already.
Rossi.
And the core of this team has been built. It's amazing how the Wild have been built. When you look at other rosters, there are some teams that are like 18 out of their 20 guys will be Canadian. And our roster has been much more American and European, probably fewer Canadians on our roster than just about any team in the league for a long time. 10 years.
And, maybe longer.
Right. And so the European feel is very real. It's a little different right now, a little more Russian than Finnish. But Liam Ogren's probably the up-and-coming guy that I think this year he's the one that could make. Well, I suppose you could include Marco Rossi in there. He still has.
Yeah.
He's still young enough, and we're this year he could be a major impact with improvement.
And in terms of Iowa, I mean, it really depends where Volstead is. I mean, obviously, if Volstead's down there, I would say him. But I do get the impression, and we might learn a little more about that in the next coming days, because we're supposed to talk to Billy here. But, you know, do the Wild carry three goalies a lot of this season? If they do, we're going to see a lot of Volstead up here. But if it's not Volstead down there, I mean, David Spachek's the one name that comes to my mind. I mean, this guy had a tough year, his first year pro last year. But everywhere he's ever played, whether it's on the junior team or in the Worlds, he's just excelled. I'm actually hoping I'm going to Prague on Friday, and I'm hoping to sit down with him and his dad, who I happen to cover in Florida, and absolutely, he was one of my favorite players I ever covered down there. So, you know, I'm hoping to sit down with them. But Spachek's one guy I could see really excelling this year. And just of all those defensemen in Iowa, he's the one I'm expect, if you consider that Damon Hunt had a pretty decent year, I'm expecting Spachek to take the biggest rise of all those guys down there. So we'll see. Hold on to your question. I want to invite Don from Feller's Ranch up, and then we'll have you come back on up. Don, you want to come on up here? And
I think we're going to grab the other mic just to keep it
okay,
easy.
Okay, cool. So Feller's Ranch.
Don is a, we should, he is one of the thousands, but probably the first that we've ever had on our show, who's claimed, one of his many claims to fame, is that he scored a goal on Kevin Gorg in a college hockey game.
Is that a claim? That doesn't seem difficult.
Well, back in those days, St. Thomas was a little bit better than St. John's, but there was a Savakul goal. You told me that, and I went and looked it up just to confirm it, and it did, in fact, happen. Not that I didn't believe you, but I did go double-check.
Yeah, that's your job to fact-check.
Was it a cheesy goal, or did you dangle?
Oh, no.
Oh, you dangled like 3D.
A backhand in the upper corner.
Nice. Did you know that during the 4 years, so Don and I were at St. John's at the same time. During the 4 years up there, I was doing games on the radio while you were playing. St. John's only had one win against St. Thomas in those 4 years.
Wow. Yeah,
that was
at
it.
St. Thomas.
It was at St. Thomas game. Game.
Right.
Very
right.
Cool.
I block out all those losses. I just remember the win.
Yeah, they all kind of run together.
So tell us about Feller's Ranch.
Yeah. First of all, thank you both
for having
us here, and pleasure to be here and share our story. Feller's Ranch is a farm located near Conger, Minnesota, and it's a group of people that had a common interest in finding the best beef to supply to local restaurants and individuals. And after lots of research, we decided to get into the Wagyu business. Wagyu is a breed that has its foundation or origins in Japan. You might have heard of Kobe beef. Wagyu is basically the umbrella that Kobe falls under. And we found a large herd of Wagyu that was available from a guy from Wyoming, the state of Wyoming, not the town of Wyoming.
They weren't just wandering the streets here by Split Rocks.
That's right. But he was retiring, and it was an opportunity. One of our partners owns the butcher shop, an artesian butcher shop in Conger, Minnesota, which is right down by Albert Lea. So we love having visitors. Look it up on a map, which is southwest of Albert Lea, close to the Iowa border. And we like to say we're the Wagyu capital of the Midwest. Our product has gotten a lot of attention over the last 3 years since we started in business. We're in some of the top restaurants in Minnesota. You can find us at various locations that on a special occasion you go out for dinner. This isn't a everyday meal. It's not something that people that are just looking for the cheapest cut of beef are going to buy. This is something special.
It's Anthony's everyday meal, though.
I wish. It's frequent, but it's not quite every day. What I've always loved, and so when you guys were first getting started and you had reached out and said, you know, we're getting into this, we'd love to talk steaks, and there are so many reasons why this particular cattle produces such a high quality of beef. But one of them, when I met with you guys and I learned a lot about it from you guys, was the slow process and how long you keep them alive, how slowly you add weight to them to add more marbling and more flavor to the steak?
Yeah, excellent question, Anthony. And that is a real common question. What's different about Wagyu beef versus conventional beef that you buy at the grocery store? We've all seen the large feedlots across the Midwest, or you drive west through Nebraska and Colorado, huge feedlots where their goal is to put on as much weight as fast as possible and get those animals to the processing facility as soon as possible. So the average age at processing or harvest weight is about 14 to 16 months. Our cattle, when they are ready for processing, are 28 to 30 months. And that slow growth with individualized or very particular diets leads to what's called the intermuscular fat. And that intermuscular fat is what creates the tenderness and the excellent flavor of Wagyu. And our Wagyu isn't like some of the American, you'll hear the term American Wagyu, which has become popular throughout the country as people got on the Wagyu bandwagon. And that's just a simple cross between Wagyu and Angus, or Wagyu and Hereford, different American breeds. We focus on higher percentage Wagyu, so it's closer in genetic background to Japanese Wagyu than what is commonly referred to as American Wagyu.
I know this is a high-stress cattle, too, so I know in Japan sometimes they'll talk about that they try to keep them really calm. They massage them. They feed them beer even to try to keep them calm. It's legitimately they do it.
Sounds like me.
Because the cattle itself, they're like a high-stress animal or something like that. Do you guys experiment any with that?
Well, yes. Not the massaging or not the beer. Yeah. Although we would like to get some byproducts from a brewery, a local brewery, that it's excellent feed source. And that's what they have done in Japan, is they feed a byproduct from the brewery process. And as far as the stress goes, yeah, one of the key factors in how does a piece of steak taste is how that animal was treated. If they lived a high stress life, especially right prior to harvest, right before they get processed, the flavor is worse, the tenderness is less. There's been all sorts of research done that if you can keep your animals in low stress environments and happy, they produce a much more appealing flavor and tenderness, and that's what we strive for. Our cattle are raised real close to where they're processed, so instead of being shipped 1,000 miles across the country, they're taken a mile to our processing facility.
And I know that isn't the rule or the whatever the, I don't know what you'd call it, the it has to be 50% Wagyu to be called Wagyu, right, by the USDA. And aren't you guys beyond that with most of the steaks you produce?
Yeah, most of our steaks exceed 75% Wagyu, but that's exactly right. The USDA has a rule. It's actually a little bit less than 50% can, if genetics, there are a lot of, it's just like people, you have mixed nationalities, cattle have mixed genetic backgrounds. And the USDA says in order to call it Wagyu, it has to be close to 50%.
How do you get Feller's Ranch? You guys have a truck also, like he's talked about. We'll talk about the van and everything.
Yeah, we have a van, a great employee, Scott Heilman's his name, excellent driver that delivers to locations throughout the Twin Cities. We also ship product, frozen product, by UPS overnight delivery with dry ice, so it arrives in excellent condition. But yes, we have a van with the Feller's Ranch logo and name all over it that some people here may have seen before.
Yeah, yeah. Fellersranch.com?
Correct, Fellersranch.com.
I know that there's a marbling scale. Right, I don't know how many grades there are in the U.S. Is it 12? I don't think there's 12 in Japan. It might be 10 in the U.S. But you have a standard that you won't even sell it as steak unless it's at a certain marbling point, right?
That's correct. There are various different marbling scores or ways to grade meat in the United States that you've often heard the term prime. And then one level down from prime is choice. One level down from choice is select. And then we have what's called commercial grades, which is, you know, goes into fast food restaurant, burgers, things of that nature. The scale we use is called the BMS, which just stands for the basic marbling score, which grades based on a cut of the ribeye to see how much intermuscular fat there is. And that's the 1 to 12 that you're talking about. And our animals, to have the Feller Ranch name, have to have 6 BMS or above. Prime stops at 4. So a BMS score of 4 is where the, you know, the top prime typically comes in at, and ours starts at 6, and wow, we often have well beyond that. So it there are a lot of factors that go into why Wagyu is more expensive than buying commercial beef, and how they're bred, how they're fed, how they're handled, and how the age they're allowed to attain. All of those factors go into it.
What's your favorite cut of steak? Like, if you could have one, Feller's Ranch is coming to your house, they're dropping off steaks, what are you going to go with?
Well, my favorite always has been ribeye, and this was before Feller's Ranch. However, since starting Feller's Ranch, you get different cuts, and we have our partner that's the butcher can do things with different cuts of steak that most butchers can't dream of. And one of the cuts I really like, if it's processed, butchered correctly, and then cooked correctly and cut correctly, is a flat iron. And that now is my favorite.
Well, and typically you can get the flat irons a little less expensively than you can get the ribeyes, and like that, your Denver cuts are the best steaks I've had maybe ever. And I'll go with that anytime I see it. There's a couple restaurants in town. We go to Baltimore a lot, and I'll always ask, what do you have from Feller's? And if they've got the Denver cut, that's what we're going with.
Yeah, the Denver cut has become real popular. And, sometimes some of these lesser-known cuts you can get at a more reasonable price. And you can find out they have a distinct flavor, a little different flavoring, but they're excellent. And we're proud to offer all of those at different places, whether it's Baltimore, 801 Chop House, various different top locations in the Twin Cities carry our products.
Awesome. Well, thanks, Don, for coming on up, and thanks for all the raffle items and the beef sticks for everybody here as well. I'll tell you what, Anthony's come a long way since he didn't know how to pronounce Akiyushi.
Akiyushi.
You mispronounced it.
No, it's Akiyushi, and it's Wagyu.
It's not Akiyushi.
Not Wagyu.
It's Akiyushi. Hey, it's Russo for Aquarius Home Services. The State Fair Mega Sale is here with up to 25% off Kinetico, the world's most efficient water treatment system. This system tackles problem water, operates without electricity, and delivers purified drinking water right from your faucet. I've had it for years. It's incredible. As your independent authorized Kinetico dealer, Aquarius offers worry-free water solutions and mega savings, starting with a free water analysis. So don't miss out. Schedule your appointment now at AquariusHomeServices.com. Aquarius, earning the right to be recommended. And remember, tell them that Russo sent you.
Can I ask a hockey question?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
All right. So I've been a college hockey fan as well as the Wild. Love mm-hmm. going to Wild fans. But the world of NIL has changed in compensation to college hockey players or athletes in general.
Just think what you could have demanded after scoring on Gorgie.
Yeah. Yeah, that peanuts you can get in. So, anyway, I'm curious what, number one, the NHL or the NCAA has prohibited players from major junior in Canada from going to the NCAA, and I don't know how they can justify that anymore now that these NCAA players are getting paid on NIL. How can they say, yeah, you can get paid while you're in college, but if you played major junior and got a stipend, you can't apply to college anymore. So what I'm wondering is, how do the pros see the evolution of the pathway to the NHL? Are more kids going to come through the NCAA with these changes or less? Just curious on your input experts in the hockey world?
Well, I have a couple opinions on it. Number one, I think the NIL and the transfer portal are going to kill college hockey, just like they won't kill it because they'll figure out a solution, but they're bad for college hockey, bad for college football, bad for college sports in general. But I think it's interesting, and this is a debate that's been going on for a long time, like what's the best way to develop hockey skill? Is it to go through NCAA or to go through major junior? And if you talk to people from Canada, they think NCAA hockey's a joke. And if you talk to people in the NCAA, they've got 8 million reasons why they think their way is the better way to go. And are you on some of those email chains where you get like the CHL press releases and everything? Mm-hmm. And everything that happens in the world of hockey, they will send out some kind of a press release that says, hey, here are all the CHL players that have won a Stanley Cup this year. Here are all the players that are going to be represented in this tournament. And look, the CHL has 60%, where NCAA has 30%. And so they are very competitive with each other. I haven't talked to a lot of the NHL general managers to get a firm, like, I wouldn't have an idea of which way, if they think one's better than the other. I think a lot of them just view it as whatever's the right fit for the player. Right.
And everything, right, like a lot of times it'll be a cycle inside an organization. Like the Wild have a ton of prospects here, so it helps them to draft college kids because then they get 4 years of rights as opposed to two. But, you know, there used to be this almost theory that if you really want a skilled player, you go get him from Europe or Canadian juniors. Now it's not that case anymore. Right. I mean, we're seeing the Cale Makars, the Celebrinis, the Fantillis, the, you know, on and on and on and on. I think it really, but to get to your other point, I don't know how there is a class action lawsuit going on right now, because it just does seem like, unfair that they're basically saying that if you play Canadian junior, they can't play in colleges. So,
and the NHL has always been, they've been very protective of the Canadian junior leagues over the years, where they make it impossible for teams to take their players and send them to the minor leagues.
Right.
If you're not going to play in the NHL, you have to let them go back. They know the value of the Canadian junior leagues to producing hockey talent. So they've been, the NHL, it doesn't have anything to do with the lawsuit, but the NHL has been very protective of the rights of the Canadian Junior Leagues.
By the way, I should mention we're going to have two live shows in September, so stay tuned to those dates on our social media and on the upcoming. We have two more podcasts this month, so we'll broadcast out where and when those live shows will be in September. And thanks, by the way, to Grain Belt and the Tuttle's restaurants. They actually extended their deal for the upcoming hockey season, so we will be doing 15 live shows between September.
Real time again, Michael.
Oh, great.
It's amazing how many times this happens during the show.
Yeah, it really is. All right, question.
Any interesting prospects that aren't already in the system that were invited to the Tom Curver's Prospect Showcase to watch?
I saw Pascal Dupuis' kid again was on there. I'll be honest, I didn't really look at the they had to add some invitees because they were going to have Kuznetsov and Ogren and players like that in the Tom Curver's prospect pool. The fact that they've pulled them from that, I think it shows you how much, one, they don't want to risk injury, and we know that the Wild have had a history of guys getting hurt in their prospect tournaments, not necessarily the Tom Curvers, because Rossi and Boldy were in that and obviously came out fine, but, you know, off the top of my head, I can remember Gustav Olsson, Mason Shaw. There have been a laundry list of guys that have gotten hurt in that, so they don't want to risk injury because Ogren and Kuznetsov have a legit chance of making the team. But in terms of invitees, I mean, you know, the prospects on there are the ones that you've heard about. I mean, I'm looking forward to seeing Hunter Haight and Riley Haight and David Spacek, as I mentioned before, and guys like that. They're playing the Slovak goalie that they're bringing over that they expect a lot from this year. It'll be pretty cool. So grab a T-shirt if you want. Question. Didn't you go to St. John's?
I did.
Yes.
Yeah, I was there almost a decade before Anthony.
No way. Anthony preceded you.
He had KSJU rolling long before I got there.
Yeah, way back in the dark ages. I've got a hockey question regarding your athletic coverage for the upcoming season.
And then mine specifically or as a whole?
As a whole.
Okay.
And then a travel question. The hockey question is, I heard you mention on one of the earlier podcasts that Joe Smith is doing paternity leave.
Mm-hmm.
That means
he's back now, though.
Okay. He's back. He's done.
He's working until like basically training camp, and then I'll go on again.
Okay.
Because at the Athletic, you could split it up.
Right. How's that going to flesh out then? Are you taking all of the games for what?
Till at least December 15th. Oh. So I'll be doing probably a lot less national the first 3 months of the season, other than going to Prague in a couple days and going to Vegas for that NHL media tour.
But you're going to be run ragged since you don't have Joe to split up the road trips.
Yeah, I mean, but
ragged. Yeah. Some of us take every trip.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, please, on your first class charter.
Yeah.
Anthony always seems to think that he's got this, like, super hard job when I would give anything to work as little as him.
I'm assuming you've checked the schedule. Does that mean you get the Tampa trip this year?
I am getting the Tampa trip, which I'm actually pissed about. Because Trampled by Turtles and Avett Brothers are at XL Energy Center when I'm there. I'm like, what are the chances?
But we have days off in South Florida.
I know, I am getting that. But I just spent freaking 2 months in South Florida for covering the Panthers. But to your point, like, what are the chances? Because we've been joking since Joe got here that he just, you know, part of his deal was he was always getting the Tampa trip. Right. And then of all the times that you know, Trampled is playing at XL Energy Center, I'm actually in Tampa. It actually kind of sucks.
The travel question I have is I'm going
to. By the way, thanks to Trampled by Turtles for the music. Victory to start this podcast and winners to end it for donating that many, many eons ago.
I'm going to be in Scotland for 2 weeks in September.
Wow.
Have either of you been? And if so, you got
many
any
times.
Tips?
Yeah.
I've not ever been.
I'm actually going to be in Glasgow, but we're staying in Carnoustie about a mile, Anthony, from the golf course.
Well, I'd go to the golf course.
Yeah.
Well. That'd be my recommendation.
Yeah.
I'll be honest. Maybe I didn't spend enough time in Glasgow. I didn't love Glasgow, but I've been to Edinburgh twice. Edinburgh is an incredible city and awesome restaurants, awesome places to walk around. But one thing that you could do that's only about 45 minutes, an hour outside of Edinburgh is go to St. Andrews. And on the way to St. Andrews, I would go on some Scotch distillery tours. The one that I love that I've been twice is Glenkinchie. Just fabulous. It's really cool. But Edinburgh, you know, what are the chances? So the first day of my first ever, this is preceded La Panta, so I went solo the first one. It was supposed to be Russo Suhan, and Suhan backed out. And so the first trip for that defined destinations trip was Scotland and Ireland. And so the first night that I'm in Scotland, like, what are the chances? At the same hotel in a city where there's a million hotels, I'm in the bar hanging out with the Tremerts. First day I met them, and I look across the bar, and there's John Anderson, the Wild assistant coach, having dinner with his daughter and his wife. I'm like, what are the chances in the same freaking hotel bar at the same time that I would be there as the Wild assistant coach at the time? So, but you'll love Edinburgh. I mean, it's the castle's amazing. All the places to shop. The royal family has an incredible home right on the outskirts of downtown. Essentially, it's beautiful.
Yeah, we've got a wedding in Glasgow. My goddaughter's getting married to a guy from Glasgow, and
nice.
Then we're doing the Highland Games, and we're going up to one of the islands. And
I thought I was going to marry a girl from Glasgow once, so that didn't happen. So,
I thought you were going to buy a cabin about 4 hours ago.
I know. I won't say who. Is it? She started dating a lead singer of a band, and every time I hear that band on the radio, I get all pissed off. So, Delamitri. Delamitri was the band. Roll to Me, every time I hear that fucking song. Anyway, you might have to beep that out. What else? So I went to the Rockies game the other day, Braves. Saw like six homers. Matt Olson smoked two, one grand slam. But here's something that I actually felt dirty about. I did the wave, Anthony.
Oh.
Yeah. And I enjoyed it. I could see why, like, the wave at a baseball game is so much different and cooler than a hockey game. I don't know what it is. It's just, like, first of all, the game was packed, and the Rockies suck. But it just, like, when you have, like, 40,000...
I can't imagine you having the energy to stand up when the wave came by.
First of all, I stood the entire game. I'll tell you about this game. So then you can't do the wave. No. Well, first of all, it was, like, a half-hearted wave. It was, like, one of these.
Well, that doesn't surprise me.
But then I kind of got into it because it went around, like, eight times. But here's the coolest part. So we got tickets to the game, and so I decided, like instead of sitting in our seats, let's, like, stand. So we stood dead center right above the Braves' bullpen. And I was fascinated. It's the first time that I've ever just sat above a bullpen and essentially watched what they do all game. Like the bullpen catcher, the bullpen manager, the bullpen coach. They had actually two bullpen catchers. But then all the relievers and all the stretching they do before. And it's kind of wild to sit there and watch it from that perspective. But what a great ballpark. I don't know if you've ever been to Coors Field.
Yeah, I've been there many times. I love the ballpark. Yeah. Great sight lines. In a great setting, and as we talked, I think, last week on the show, that area around the ballpark has really changed. It's a fun spot now. There's some good restaurants and bars around there. You didn't look up AJ while you were out there?
No, I felt bad because actually as we were walking back to the car after the game, all of a sudden I passed the Chop House. I'm like, oh, I didn't even call AJ because one of the last times I saw him in Denver, I took him and his buddies out to the Chop House. So that, you know, the place right next to Coors Field there.
Yep.
So, but I did have dinner at a restaurant that I've actually seen you guys at. I forget the name of it. Like, yeah, exactly. So I had sushi there. You should not get sushi there. That is not a place you should get sushi. I felt
Denver?
It the next day.
Just
a regular restaurant.
Yeah.
And even as, so I'm there with my friends and they're like, like, a place like this doesn't have a sushi chef. Like, what kind of sushi is it going to be? I'm like, that's kind of a good point. And then they brought it out there, and I just looked at it right away. I'm like, this was, like, brought out of the, I almost said a local place here, but I won't do that. I won't get in trouble. I'm trying to think what else is going on. You know who I had lunch with yesterday? Stéphane Veilleux, who was, and I'll be writing more about this in the coming weeks, but he was in that car accident in June and broke his C1 vertebrae, burst it. So lucky. That he is not paralyzed or worse, but he is in a...
Is C1 the top?
Yeah.
So normally that's the most dangerous, isn't it?
He is in a... I knew he was in a halo vest. I didn't really know what a halo vest was. Like, I just figured it was like a neck brace where you just take it off and on. I mean, that thing is drilled into his head. It is. But his... just sitting with him yesterday, his strength... is like, I'm always amazed at people that are in traumatic accidents like that, where like one day you're just fine and then a minute later, you know, you have this traumatic accident and the strength that you need to overcome that. And his attitude is unbelievable. He's continuing to coach kids.
No paralysis is the expected result?
No, but in about a month and a half, they're going to take it off and do the CT scan. But it's a really unbelievable story. So I'm looking forward to writing this. And as you know, Steph, the way his career went, he's tackling it with the same type of intense, like it's just crazy how strong he is. I probably shouldn't give away the story more than that, but it's going to be a really, that story probably will be something I'll write on the plane to Prague. And so it'll be probably next week that I would think it would be out. As long as I talk to a couple other people that I get on the phone here in the next couple days and get all my interviews done. Trying to think of anything else going on. Any more questions? There's got to be more. Come on up. How are you? What's up?
Where we're at today, you know, I'm going to list some names, and if you guys can give me what you think today, the percent chances they'll still be on the roster at the end of the year.
At the end of the year, okay.
Yeah. So Gustafson, Goudreau, Rossi, and Johansson.
I think Johansson almost 100.
Yeah, I mean, if the Wild are out of a playoff spot at the deadline, somebody will take a chance on him for fourth or fifth round pick in the last year of his deal. So Johansson, I would think, would be potentially traded. Maybe even if they are in a playoff spot, you might move him just to, if you have a guy that's ready to come on up. Like a guy like Kumpelainen might be ready to come over. Yurov might be ready to come over. And so like this year with Huzandinov, if you know that a week later you might get Yurov to come here, then maybe you want to create some roster room. Gustafson, same sort of thing. Everything depends on how he plays and how he does. But I would think he's here. If they're going to move Rossi, it won't be in the middle of the year. It would be next summer. And who was the last one?
Goudreau.
Well, Goudreau is the one guy that if he's still on the team at the start of this season, it's going to depend how he's playing. But... you know, he's somebody that I really genuinely think the Wild are trying to move him. Not so much that they don't want him. I just think that if you can get out of the 4 years on his contract right now, you would do it. And maybe they have, in their minds, now a partner now that because Dean is in Columbus, but that again, Dean's not the GM there. So
no, but he'll have some say. Yeah. I would say out of all those guys, Gustafson's probably the least likely to be here at the end of the season just because of the goaltending situation. I just think there's going to be a point during the season where somebody's going to need a goaltender. Looks like the Wild are going to have an extra one, and even if he's playing well, I have a feeling like it wouldn't shock me at all if he was gone before the season's over.
And then what do you think our number one draft pick, Boyum, do you think, what are the odds that he gets an NHL game this season?
Hey, everyone. Attorney Jerry Bosch here with Bosch Law Firm and WorkCompExperts.com. For almost 30 years, we've represented Minnesotans just like you all over the great state of Minnesota to guarantee they've been treated fairly and with respect when they've suffered a work-related injury. A work injury can change your life in an instant. You need someone on your side who can help you focus on getting back on your feet and getting paid while you do. You may be entitled to medical benefits, wage loss benefits, job placement, retraining, and payment for permanent disability. To make sure you are being paid all the work comp benefits you're entitled to, please call the attorneys at Bosch Law Firm. The call is always free, and there's never a fee unless we recover benefits on your behalf. Call 651-333-8300, Bosch Law Firm, or visit us at WorkCompExperts.com.
Royal Credit Union's smart checking accounts offer no monthly fees and no minimum balance. Make the switch to a Royal checking account, and you'll also get real-time transaction alerts, free mobile check deposits, and surcharge-free access to over 40,000 ATMs across the U.S. Enjoy financial freedom with no minimum balance and no monthly fees when you switch to Royal's smart checking account. Learn more and open your Royal Credit Union smart checking account online at rcu.org/gochecking. Insured by NCUA.
We do want to thank Twilt and the Edina Galleria. I don't know if you've been to the Edina Galleria. It's a beautiful place to shop, a very comfortable place to shop, easy parking, easy in and out, really good restaurants there to hang out in if you want to do that. But if you walk by Twilt, you'll see that the shop reflects their products. It's a very down-to-earth, easygoing, attractive space with expert associates working there who are not pushy at all. They're just there to answer your questions and help steer you in the right direction if you need steering. And you go in there and just walk by, get a look, and then go back. When you want to buy clothes for yourself, when you buy somebody a present, whatever the case might be, go in and realize that Scott Dayton handpicks everything in his shop. Scott Dayton's the proprietor. It is Twilled by Scott Dayton. Scott's been a friend of mine and has been supporting this network for a long time. I buy all of my clothes there. My wife loves the place. Every time we go in there, we buy more than we expected to buy because my wife likes it so much. Their stuff fits. It wears well. I just went on a European vacation where everything I wore was from Twilled. He said, you get out of an 8-hour flight and you're not even wrinkled. The stuff just wears well. You can buy everything from golf, you know, from running shoes, walking shoes, golf shorts to beautiful Italian suits that you can wear anywhere, you know, to any occasion. So just check out twillmn.com. Sign up for their email notifications. They will not spam you. They'll just send you something if they're going to have a special event.
Well, I mean, I think the hope is that he's going to be in the Frozen Four. And then if, you know, when it's over, if there's still time in the season, I haven't looked at the dates, but you know, Faber played in the Frozen Four and still was able to sign and get two regular season games and playoffs. It's going to really depend on whether or not he wants to come back, all that type of stuff. So,
I would think if Denver's in the Frozen Four, he'll have been in the Frozen Four a couple of years in a row. I would guess he might then turn pro.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say pretty good shot that we see him just very similar to the Faber timing.
Now, that doesn't mean that if he gets those games and even gets playoff games that he's on the roster the following year. I mean, he could still go to the minors. He's, you know, I think Faber, they felt was a pro game ready, pro body, all that stuff. Like Boyum, you know, he's more of an undersized guy, like, you know, all that type of stuff. But I think there's definitely a good opportunity.
Well, and the difference with Faber was he was a year further in his college career, and I don't think they expected he was going to play in the playoffs that year.
Yeah.
They were going to give him two games out of three, and then he played so well that they, well, let's consider this guy. But that wasn't the plan when they signed him.
Yeah. Any others?
No, but I was just to say I was late because I took the tuk-tuk here.
Oh, yeah. The tuk tuk. You were the only person from that trip that came here. I was trying to, I called it a rickshaw on the drive up here. There you go.
And it was shocking that you bailed on the tuk tuk.
I had food poisoning, Anthony. Yeah. My God. Yeah.
We could have stopped at an emergency room.
It would have been an embarrassing thing, especially for the people in the tuk tuk with me.
Yeah. With the Olympics coming up and NHL players actually being able to participate in the upcoming NHL Olympics, what players from the Wild do you think might be participating? And do you think that we will see Russia or some form of Russian Confederation kind of thing be able to participate in that?
It really completely 100% depends on whether or not Russia is still inside Ukraine. I mean, that is like, you know, there's a reason why it's four nations right now and Russia's not part of it. And right now, if the IIHF is not willing to budge on this, I mean, they're not going to be part of it. So it's unfair for the current Russian players, but I get it. In terms of Wild players that would be in the Olympics, I mean, if you're talking to the United States, Boldy and Faber obviously have an incredible shot. Maybe even a Boyum, probably not, just at his age at that point. But, I mean, Eriksson Ek, Brodin,
Yeah, those rosters will be largely similar to what you see right now with the
four nations.
Just 2 years later. So a couple veterans will probably fall off and a couple younger guys will step in. Mm-hmm. But I think you'll see the Swedes well represented with Wild players.
Yep. I mean, obviously, Rossi's not going to play in the Olympic qualifier coming up here. So if they don't qualify, he won't be part of it. It's a shame there. They're in a tough group anyway with Slovakia. Trying to think off the top of my head, other guys on the team. I mean, Foligno, Hartman, I'm just going there. Zuccarello, if Norway makes it, he'll be in it.
He should be with Sweden.
Yeah.
Rodin and Eriksson Ek both will be a part of the Swedish team.
Yeah, one would think. And the Four Nation, remember, they have a much more a stricter
smaller roster.
So, you know, even if, let's just say a Boldy or a Faber doesn't make the Four Nations, that doesn't mean that they won't make the Olympics. There'll be more, you know, a larger roster, taxi squad, things like that, where Four Nations, if you have injuries, you're screwed, essentially, one of these teams.
Is the Four Nations replacing the All-Star week then?
Yep. Yeah.
So then Kaprizov might actually get that week off. I feel like
he will
have it off.
Yeah.
Maybe
actually, wait a minute.
That.
Is there an All-Star game this year?
No,
I think there is, right?
I think this replaced the All-Star week.
No, I think there is still an All-Star game, right? I'm pretty positive, yeah.
I could have sworn I read that they were doing this instead.
I'm trying to think.
It's a lot of players that wouldn't be a part of the All-Star game.
Yeah. Well, no, I'm just saying that it's not... I'm conflating the two.
I could have sworn
I read that
this was replacing it.
Yeah.
Could be wrong.
Somebody listening here knows. It's not being held. Okay, so the Olympics, though, so the Olympic year, I think they are going to have an All-Star game, which is odd. They sometimes will get rid of it. Actually, in 98, though, I still remember all those guys. Not 98, 2010. Trying to remember when I remember Gavrik and all those guys staying over. It would have been 2006 Olympics. They were all like staying in Vancouver when we were there and then getting on a plane and going over to Torino. So you have a question? And we're going to probably wrap up the show.
We have a raffle to get to.
Yeah, we have a raffle to get to.
No. Oh, yeah.
Oh, no, we'll give you a ticket when it's over. Still got to ask a question. I like Black Rifle Coffee Company. Yep.
So, thanks. I can stand on my tippy toes. I was telling that. Thank you. Hi. Piggybacking a little bit off of a couple podcasts you guys have done with front office or executives, and then what you mentioned about the recent accident, I was curious, it's not super hockey related, but with so many injuries in professional sports and hockey, if something comes to mind, like a major comeback from a catastrophic injury that either one of you could recall, and then also for you're both very successful and you've, to my knowledge, have been so for a long time, but was there something in your early career, because we know you as successful for a long period of time, that you can recall it yourself where you had to overcome adversity, if it's not an injury, but something that you could share that just really made you pivot or was unexpected, like mm-hmm. you mentioned with in the case of an injury or something, maybe not injury for you guys, but if that
yeah, I mean, injury would make me cower and quit.
But if there was a moment in your career that pivoted or unexpected. Thank you.
The first thing I thought of was I was on a flight from Buffalo to LaGuardia once when we were hit by lightning, and I was thinking on that plane that if I survive, I was going to quit. But I wound up continuing. I mean, for me, I think it was like I look back now and I kind of laugh. I mean, you know, and Anthony sort of had a similar path. Like, you don't just wake up one day and call Wild games or wake up one day and cover a professional team and get a job for a newspaper. You do have to grind it out. I was lucky enough to get my foot in the door at the Sun Sentinel at age 15. And even though I laugh now that it took, you know, at 21, I was covering the Panthers. I look back now at like, I was covering high schools and colleges and things like that for 6 years and running quotes for Associated Press and all this stuff. And I remember being like, I'm like, how come they're not giving me my big shot yet? How come they're not giving me my big shot? But I look back, that's 6 years of covering high schools. But what that did is it teaches you how to work hard, you know, maybe less, you know, at that point, you know, the people reading you are just, you know, parents of kids and grandparents of kids. It's not the most, you know, high-profile beat that you're covering, but it makes you really learn how to be a sports writer because you don't have a statistician giving you stats, you don't have a PR department arranging interviews, you're having to work. And so, to me, I got really fortunate in my career. I've only had three jobs in my life, Sun Sentinel, Star Tribune, and The Athletic. I did work at Toys R Us once, but then I was there 5 months as a cashier. Then one day they handed me a mop and I walked into the bathroom to clean up what they wanted me to clean up. And that was my last day. So I guess four jobs in my life.
Well, my path was a little different in that I had about, I'm going to say 500 moments that were like that. And if Margo were here, she could come up with another 500 where it was, I think I was about maybe 0 for about 120 on jobs for which I applied and didn't get hired. And I can't remember a job that I got that was a job for which I did apply. Every job I ever got was they called me. Everything I ever tried to find, I couldn't get somebody to call me back. I couldn't get people to listen to my tapes. And the number of times that, then there were a few where I was in the hunt as a finalist. And those calls when they would come to say, well, we decided to go another way, every single year were just crushing. And Margo would remember more of the stories probably because, you know, every spring, are we going to get a baseball job? Are we going to get a next fall? Are we going to get a hockey job? And they just never happened. So we had a whole bunch of those. But the one, I think I've shared the story before, that maybe the low point of my broadcasting career, I did any game anybody would let me do. I did soccer, volleyball. I did the Special Olympic soccer tournament 1 year. I did wrestling. I did baseball. I did anything anybody would let me do. And 1 year I agreed to do the World Ringette Tournament. And I'd never heard of ringette. I said, I'll do it. There were four teams playing, and the U.S. was in, it was here, so the U.S. got to have a team in it. They got blown out in the semifinal, so the expert analyst was so pissed off they didn't show up to do the game with me the next night. So I'm driving home after doing a tape-delayed Czechoslovakia versus Russia ringette game by myself because the analyst didn't show up. And I remember driving home thinking, I had these dreams of, like, doing Stanley Cup playoff games. And instead, I just got done with a tape-delayed broadcast of a sport I don't know anything about, and the broadcast meant so little to my analysts, they didn't even come. And I was like, maybe I had to rethink this career choice for a little while. But so there were a lot of low points for me along the way, and it worked out great, but there were a lot of years where it was, I don't know what we're going to do if I don't get this job or that job or something doesn't happen.
Yeah, the other good thing about covering preps is that you get you become versatile. Like, I covered everything, cross-country, track, soccer, wrestling. I mean, you know, like, so you learn every sport. Obviously, the big ones, football, basketball, and baseball. And down in South Florida, football was king. I covered A-Rod in high school, you know, things like that. Fred Taylor, Travis Henry. I mean, so many incredibly good athletes that I'm so old have since retired. But it makes you, you know, I think the biggest adversities that I've had in my life that I wouldn't call adversity is, and, you know, I'm a big believer in, like, you know, life changes with every decision you make. What if I took a left turn instead of a right? It's like the Dave Matthews song. I could be a millionaire in Bel Air or a parking lot attendant, you know, like that type of lyric. But I had to make really tough decisions. I turned on a lot of jobs at the Sun Sentinel with other newspapers, but the Star Tribune's the one that I just knew was right. So I moved to the Strib. And then for some reason in 2017, I had the guts to go to the Athletic when it was at that point nothing. Let's wrap up the show. You know, one thing I did want to mention at the end of the show is Sam Rosen's retiring. He's having a goodbye year, kind of a Marc-Andre Fleury so long tour. And Sam Rosen is one of the classiest people I've ever met. I mean, everything you've seen on Twitter about people giving accolades to the way he treated them as young reporters, young broadcasters, is everything absolutely true about this guy. I mean, from the moment I met him when I was 21 years old to now, 30 years later, 29 first years later,
guy.
First class guy, unbelievable guy. Really, really looking forward to seeing Sam twice this season do Wild Rangers games. And I think that's it, Anthony. Now I'm going to fumble and try to remember here the sponsors to say goodbye. So Davide is going to have to do some magic in the editing. Mm-hmm. By the way, I cannot wait for Prague. I mean, the list of players is spectacular, so can't wait that. But for some reason, Niederreiter is the one I'm looking forward to seeing most. Thanks to our incredible sponsors, and thanks for coming out here to Split Rocks, everybody. We're going to do the raffles here in a second with Feller's Ranch. Again, we'll have two live shows in September, so pay attention to our social media and the next two podcasts, and we'll give you those. But thanks to everybody for joining us from the Aquarius Home Services studio. Feller's Ranch, Twill in the Edina Galleria, Bosch Law Firm, and Royal Credit Union. Thanks for coming on out, everybody.
Thank you.
All but the world.